When it comes to sports, there are certain players that you always respect and admire. Obviously, somebody like that for me would be a Michael Jordan or a Walter Payton. Then there are those people that you always like to make fun of for this or that, even if it's petty or even if it's something legit and serious. For me, that might be somebody like a Peyton Manning, you know, just as one example. But then there are those teams that you respect and admire for the way they conduct business, the way they do things. And then on the flip side, there are those teams that are fun to mock because they are stuck in a perpetual cycle of complete and utter stupidity. Now, one of my favorite organizations to have fun at the expense of, beyond question in any sport, is the Cleveland Browns. And let me give you a little backstory as to why. This is a Cleveland Browns organization that came back into being in 1999 after the 1995 season was the last season of the Browns being in Cleveland because you could say what you want. We could put our own creative spins on history of Art Modell was going to take the team no matter what. The city didn't give him the stadium, what he wanted, when he wanted it, this and that. You can talk about whose fault it was, but the bottom line is the Cleveland Browns went to Baltimore, became the Ravens, and have won two Super Bowls since. And the new incarnation of the Cleveland Browns that have been back for 15 seasons going into their 16th season in the 2014 calendar year haven't really done jack squat. Look at this organization's initial first-round pick since 2005, talking about based off of their finish during the regular season, assuming they had their own first-round picks, not talking about trades or anything else. Since 2005, they've had the number 3 pick, the number 12 pick, the number 3 pick, the number 22 pick, number 5, number 7, number 6, number 4, number 6, number 4. Just think about that for a second. In the past 10 seasons, or 10 drafts, if you will, from 2005 to this most recent one, 2014, the Cleveland Browns, out of those 10 picks, had 8 picks in the top 10, and 5 of those 8 were in the top bloody 5. And part of the reason for that, a primary reason for that, is the incompetence at the very top coming down from the ownership on down. Here are the head coaches the Cleveland Browns have had since 2005. Romeo Crennel, Eric Mangini, Pat Shurmur, Rob Chudzinski, and now another coach. Think about that. This is now with Mike Pettine, you're going on 5 head coaches in 10 seasons. And I've lost counts of the general managers and team presidents. I think it's close to that number. Maybe 3 general managers or 4 in that time frame. 5 head coaches in 10 seasons has equated to 8 top 10 picks over the past 10 years, 5 of which were in the top 5. Yet the Cleveland Browns continue to perpetually be stuck in that cycle of stupidity of doing the same thing over and over again and somehow imagining that the results are magically going to change and be different. Wow. And they wonder why they don't. And some Cleveland Browns fans, I don't even think wonder anymore why they don't. They know. Apparently the only people that don't know are the people in the Cleveland Browns organization, most notably the owner of the Cleveland Browns organization, the crook himself, Jimmy Haslam. Now it's Ray Farmer and Mike Pettine's time to have a go at it for a year or two before they're ultimately fired. You know, the biggest thing here for Ray Farmer and the new head coach, Mike Pettine, they need time and they need patience. They need to be given an opportunity, a real opportunity like a real professionally run organization would do to give them 4, maybe even God forbid in Cleveland, 5 bloody flipping years to see them put a vision in place, a direction in place, follow that vision and direction, and see where it leads the organization. This organization needs steady leadership and direction and vision and all of these things that they frankly haven't had since they came back into being in the league in 1999. All this hot potato of general managers and team presidents and head coaches has resulted in 8 top 10 picks over the past 10 years, and 5 of those 8 being in the top 5. Things haven't been good. So now it was incumbent upon Ray Farmer and Mike Pettine to do something positive with the 2014 NFL draft, to put their stamp on the organization until 2 years later where they're fired and somebody else tries to do the same thing again. And that is try to give this franchise that frankly, just frankly needs something. They need a spark. They need a lift. They need a vision. They need leadership. They need direction. They need everything. They need star power. They needed to get it out of this draft. And when you look at the results of their draft down below in the description box, I will say this above all else. When you look at the head coach and you look at the general manager, it seemed like they had a vision and direction for what they wanted to accomplish and where they want to go. I may not necessarily completely fully agree with that vision or that direction, but they have one nonetheless. And I think that's something that is very important at this point in time for the Cleveland Browns organization to have, and that's very something very important for the Cleveland Browns fans to have as a glimmer of hope, a beacon of hope to believe again in this organization that, frankly, has never really given you a reason to believe, at least since, probably the 60s. Just saying, Paul Warfield's not walking through that door anymore. Jim Brown's not walking through that door anymore. Leroy Kelly's not walking through that door anymore. Gene Hickerson isn't walking through that door anymore. Neither are Otto Graham, Marion Motley, or Lou Groza. Yeah, I went there. But when you look at the 2014 NFL draft with those results down below, like I said, you could see that there was a vision and there was a direction. You can see that. And when I look at this, it's kind of one of these things. You could see some nice things in place, but this is kind of an incomplete draft because we don't know the full story for it. As far as the Cleveland Browns being able to trade back from pick number 4 down to pick number 9 with the Buffalo Bills and then being able to acquire a first and fourth round pick in the 2015 draft to be able to move down just 5 spots was a stroke of genius by Ray Farmer. A great move because this sets them up as they were big time potential power players here in 2014 in this draft. They're right back in that same position again in 2015 as power players with potentially 2 decent first round picks and a couple of additional mid round picks. A great job by Ray Farmer, understanding that he was in a good favorable position to accumulate some additional draft currency to help the organization both now and in the long term. And when you look at their draft, they also traded away a 7th rounder this year to the Ravens, who took Michael Campanaro, the wide receiver from Wake Forest, to acquire a 6th round pick in next year's draft. I put it this way, anytime you could take a 7th round pick in one draft and flip it into a 6th round pick in the next draft, you've done yourself a very good job. It's like taking a 3rd rounder this year, turning it into a 2nd rounder next year. Anytime you can accomplish that, you have done something really good. And when I look at the Browns draft, there are some things to like. I do like the selection of Johnny Manziel for them at number 22. They need a quarterback. And until the Cleveland Browns find that quarterback, that guy that could be that franchise player, the guy that could be that leader, that could be that difference maker, they're never going to get anywhere. And they failed in the past with the Tim Couches and the Brady Quinns and the Brandon Whedons. And now you bring Johnny Manziel in the fold, but a different type of quarterback. Not that staid, kind of boring, traditional pocket passer. A new type of quarterback for a new era of the National Football League. Easily, to me, the best pick the Cleveland Browns made. When you look at the best value on the board for them, in round 4, being able in the later portions of the round to be able to get a corner from Lindenwood like Pierre Desir with size and speed that could potentially develop into a long-term starting corner in the National Football League, I thought that was really good value. A pick that could surprise that a lot of people aren't talking about. Maybe some people think I would say like a Joel Bitonio, the offensive lineman from Nevada. I think he's a plug-and-play day one starter, but I think the bigger surprise from this class could be their 3rd round pick that they traded up to get from Towson in Terrence West. Here's a guy that I saw dominate at the FCS level. Here's a guy that I was very high on in this draft, had him as one of my top 7 running backs on the board, thought he was a 3rd round pick, and I think he's a guy that could surprise people. He could compete with Ben Tate at some point in time in 2014 for carries and potentially take over the job from Ben Tate before the 2014 season is over. Now, when I talk about vision and I talk about direction for the Cleveland Browns, and I say at least they've got one, and they do, and they clearly did in this draft, it doesn't mean I still don't question certain things about it, and there's quite a bit of second guessing for me when it comes to this Cleveland Browns draft in 2014. First and foremost, history's repeating itself again. In 2007, they took Joe Thomas, and then they traded back up into round 1 to get Brady Quinn. So pick 3, and then I think it was pick 22. They picked a quarterback. They picked another position player first. So that worked out so well with Brady Quinn that 5 years later, the Cleveland Browns did the same damn thing with Trent Richardson and Brandon Whedon. Again, taking Whedon, I believe it was at number 22. Now you fast forward 2 years later, in 2014, they're taking a corner in the top 10. And they're taking another quarterback, this time trading up from 26 to 22 to get a guy think about this for a second, to get a guy like a Johnny Manziel, when again, he might not have even necessarily been the best quarterback on the board. And in my opinion, he wasn't. I thought that was Teddy Bridgewater. And to me, when I saw the reports of the Cleveland Browns sitting there doing a study, getting a study commissioned and paying $100,000 for it to tell them that Teddy Bridgewater was the best quarterback in this draft in different measurables, they still took Manziel anyways. What the fuck are you doing? Why would you take a defensive back in the top 10? Why? Why not just sit there if you've traded down? Why not just take Manziel in the top 10 and then get an offensive playmaker or help on the offensive line, somebody on the offensive side of the ball to help him with that other first-round pick? If you were going to sit there and just take Johnny Manziel if he was going to drop, then why not just sit put at number 4 and take Sammy Watkins or Mike Evans? Especially knowing before the draft when you head in that Josh Gordon could potentially be suspended for the entire 2014 season. And even if you were assuming that Josh Gordon was going to play all of 2014, are you going to put your hopes at the other wide receivers with guys like Greg Little and Travis Benjamin? Yeah, I don't think so. Nobody with a sane mind would do that. Brad Nessler called him Mr. Dependable, but that's because Brad Nessler is a moron. That's the best way I'll put it. So you're sitting here and you're completely ignoring a big-time position of need in wide receiver. You don't even take one at all. You needed to take a couple of them, even with Josh Gordon in the fold for all of 2014. And here, with Josh Gordon not being around potentially for all of the year, you're bringing in a young quarterback like Johnny Manziel, and you're giving him no help on the outside. You're not giving him any pieces to work with. Absolutely ridiculous. And again, seems so very typically Cleveland Browns to me. So even with a vision, even with direction, that doesn't necessarily make it the right vision in the right direction, in my humble opinion. You know, when I look at this, like I said, this is the third time in 7 drafts or 8 drafts, whatever you want to say, that the Browns took another position player and then took a quarterback later. How many times are you going to do the same thing and expect any different results, even though you keep getting the same results with it? And to me, they didn't even take the best quarterback available on the board. But a guy like Johnny Manziel does bring hope, and he brings a different type of presence to Cleveland. He instantly, to me, injects that organization with hope and enthusiasm, and he injects that fan base with that same hope and enthusiasm that things can change, that things can be different, that the Cleveland Browns are going to be with the times in the NFL. I almost said WWE there for a second. They could be with the times. They could be ahead of the times. They could be part of that new generation of the NFL. They've got another young quarterback of the future, but a different type of quarterback of the future as opposed to the Tim Couches and the Brady Quinns and the Brandon Whedons of the world. The farmer's market was in full effect here. You saw Ray Farmer, the general manager, execute several trades, trading down, trading up, accumulating 3 additional picks for 2015, moving up back down the board from 4 to 9, moving up one pick to make sure Minnesota didn't take Justin Gilbert at 8 since that was their guy, you know, sitting there moving up from 26 to 22 to take Johnny Manziel, trading up to number 94 to take Terrence West. They were moving all up and down throughout this draft and did a masterful job of not only getting picks that helped them this year, but picks that can help them next year and into the future. You know, again, though, I'm talking about it again. A position player and then a quarterback later. They've done it twice before and it hasn't really worked. Why do they think the third time's going to be the charm? And to me, not getting one wide receiver here was completely mind-boggling. Yes, I understand Joel Bitonio was a nice prospect at number 35, but not with a guy like Marquise Lee on the board or maybe even an Allen Robinson or a Paul Richardson on the board. You take a young quarterback knowing you potentially don't even have Josh Gordon in the fold for all of 2014, and then you don't give him any help on the outside. Speed kills in the NFL, and you have to have those skill position players on the outside. And the Cleveland Browns didn't address this position not one time in a draft that was historically good in wide receiver talent both early and often throughout the entire draft process. Not one of them. You're really going to tell me that Christian Kirksey was the 71st best player on the board in the 2014 NFL draft? I guarantee you there are going to be 4 or 5 wide receivers taken after him that will be better NFL players than him. Even if he's a solid pro, there will be 4 or 5 wide receivers that have better, longer, more productive NFL careers. Not taking one of them was completely ridiculous. But in part 2, I do have to point out that with the Cleveland Browns, I like some of the players that they took. I like some of the things that they did. But the grading of this in part is ultimately going to be determined long-term by what they also do with the 2015 NFL draft. And that leaves me a little hopeful for the Cleveland Browns. They took the strong position that they were in here in 2014. They basically turned Trent Richardson, that mistake, into Johnny Manziel. It's got to be considered a plus and an upgrade. They took that, and, you know, on top of that, they built onto it by doing the same thing again. They took the number four pick and turned it into number nine, which they moved to number eight and created opportunities to have a first and fourth round pick next year, additional picks. Took a seventh round pick this year to make a sixth round pick next year. I like the way that Ray Farmer maneuvered his picks up and down the board. I like how he treated the draft picks as currency, accumulated some additional currency for next year. So I gave the Cleveland Browns overall a grade of B-. At the end of the day, though, this draft will be measured by one thing and one thing only, and that'll be by Johnny Manziel. If Johnny Manziel becomes that difference maker in Cleveland, he becomes that franchise quarterback, he becomes that pillar of hope, that guy that can lead the Browns back to the playoffs, then this will be an A-plus draft, and anything they get out of those picks that they acquired in 2015 will just be icing on the cake.